Welcome to the Madness. My name is Francesco Spagnolo, curator of the collection. And tonight we're talking about the gallery and the archive. We're talking about artists working with the Madness collection, a collection of 17,000 memory objects from all over the world. A collection that we, working here, pride ourselves as coming an open source collection. A collection that's open for interpretation, but also for access, including physical access. In the course of the past several years, we've been collaborating with each one of you. So welcome David Wilson, Greg Niedermeyer, and Nikki Green. Going backwards, Nikki Green, a student for just a few more weeks, essentially a student at UC Berkeley. Greg Niedermeyer, a professor of art practice at UC Berkeley, and David Wilson, an artist resident of the Bay Area. We've collaborated over the years in very different types of projects that range from giving David access to the collection storage to go and select objects and draw as he does, and you see it. They are very minute portraits of the objects, but also taking notes of our conversations and then creating an exhibition not here, but in a different institution at the Contemporary Jewish Museum in San Francisco. I would say an ongoing conversation with Greg Niedermeyer and, in a way, a series of study sessions, text study and visual study, that then culminated in an artwork that's based on data, but also based on the collection itself, and that was integrated in an exhibition called The Power of Attention that was on display last year, last academic year. And Nikki Green being sort of pinged by the curator of the collection, that's me still, and invited to interact specifically with a type of object, a very, very specific type of object, and thinking about the connection, so knowing your work, your art and your work, and thinking about how you could respond and integrating this work in a new exhibition that's actually on display right now. So we're talking about creativity, memory, the archive, exhibiting what it means to put your work on display, but also always in the context of, as I was saying, 17,000 memory objects and the memory that they carry with them. So the way this is going to work is that we invited David, Greg, and Nikki to present on their work in general and specifically in relationship with the Magnus collection. We also have a special contribution. She's not yet on stage, but she will join us, by Julie Franklin, our beloved colleague and registrar of the collection, who will also address the hands-on work that she carried out with each one of you. And we'll open up all the remarks to questions and more ideas. And we're also, last but not least, celebrating the fact that some results of the work that was done by David are coming back into the collection we'll talk about it later, but as a very generous gift of drawings. So kind of trying to paint a full circle and some kind of an ecosystem that involves archive, memory, creativity, art, exhibitions, and collecting all in one swoop. So I guess my work here is almost done, essentially. And please join me in welcoming our guests, David Wilson, Greg Niedermeyer, and Nikki Green this evening.
All right, thank you for inviting us back. It'll be lovely to hear about your projects, and nice to have a chance to reflect back on the one that I worked on. As Francesco mentioned, the project that I did was actually a collaboration directly with Francesco as part of the Contemporary Jewish Museum's Havruta exhibition series, which pairs two people, and the idea of two people with different practices working together and kind of being able to cross-pollinate in their practices. So this was actually kind of a blind date, basically. Renny Pritikin, the curator, introduced us and thought we would have a nice experience working together.
So we were curating.
Yes, exactly. So that was a welcome thing. And so I'll give a quick background to just where I'm coming from that led to this project. But basically, my work tends to kind of oscillate between drawing and organizing. And drawing for me tends to be, you know, alone time, working on site, often out in the landscape, and either with kind of brief drawings or more sustained durational drawings. So this is a drawing that actually I was working on kind of around the same time that I was working here, which is basically over the course of about 4 months sitting on top of the Claremont Canyon Hill and then working in panels and kind of returning each day with a different panel and continuing from memory of where I last left off and then connecting it all in the end. So this is a 22-foot long drawing and 12 feet tall. So it's this is like one of the more sustained of things. But then again, often organizing is a part of it, bringing people together, often in these sites and spaces that I've gotten to know. And so this is a performance and a recording session happening out in the Presidio as part of a show that I did with SF MoMA a couple years ago. So this is again, you know, kind of more of that organizing side of things. And right before working on this project, I had organized an exhibition at the Berkeley Art Museum called The Possible, which was kind of a culmination of many years of collaborations and artist projects and community engagement, basically. So in being able to invite a lot of people into a shared situation that could kind of be one of the last things in that museum's space before they transition out of the building. So kind of using the building was part of the fun. So we set up studios and, you know, had a whole series of events and a lot of things going on. So I was kind of fried by the end of that. Basically, it was like a daily festival. It felt like it was people rolling through. So actually, when I got the invitation from Rennie to meet with Francesco and hear a little about what the Magnus was doing, and I had my first visit to see the collection, I was immediately kind of like, you know, just, it felt like this kind of warm embrace of reminding myself about that alone time kind of experience. So going from this like hyper social communication based project of just kind of, you know, keeping things, you know, moving in this museum, and then getting to kind of return to the practice that, again, as I think of it, like refills my well, drawing and observation. So meeting with Francesco and realizing that there was this really kind of rich potential of working with the collection, and meeting with Julie and realizing she was going to really be able to support me kind of spending that kind of alone time with the objects, it just seemed like it was going to be a really just special, sweet moment of for me to just kind of engage these objects and just kind of explore. So it reminded me of some drawings that I had done many years ago, which were more about a collection of natural artifacts I had been collecting, often while out in these spaces, out and about where I'd organize or draw. And so usually those objects have a very personal memory attached to them. So for me, kind of spending time with the objects at home was almost like tapping back into the memory of the places that I collected them and the perhaps experiences that happened. So again, seeing the collection, it let me kind of almost take the personal memory out of the equation and see the objects as objects, and almost while drawing them, studying them, imagining who might have used them, what place they might have had in the world that they existed before they became part of this collection. And also, I, you know, as a Jewish person who doesn't have an active engagement with that tradition, not necessarily knowing what a lot of these objects were used for specifically, was also kind of a nice thing to kind of, you know, just engage these pieces as pieces. And the kind of process that Francesco and I ended up falling into is this really lovely exchange where I would kind of be let loose in the collection and could kind of just, you know, carefully open boxes and pull out, you know, objects from drawers and really just kind of, again, explore and let my more just curiosity and aesthetic engagement freely take me through the collection and settle into, you know, picking a thing to spend, you know, anywhere from 10 minutes to an hour or more with drawing. And then after a session, I would make, you know, a series of drawings, and then Francesco and I would have these very lovely meetings where we would kind of, I would show him the drawings of the objects. So it was kind of this like translation of, you know, me seeing the thing that he knows about, but him looking at my thing and trying to understand it and adding then the kind of context that I was not aware of. So this is one object that, again, I drew, and then this is the kind of process of taking notes after the sessions. And you can see at the bottom the session number kind of down here, so trying to kind of, you know, think about a collection and just how an archive works. So then these are notes, so, you know, container for the Esther scroll.
I just clarify a little bit more. So the numbers at the bottom of these drawings are accession numbers. They are unique identifiers of objects in the collection. They're not dates. They include dates of when the items came into the collection, but they're not dates of the dates of your drawings or your notes.
Right. Right?
They're identifiers of objects. So in a way, you tag
right.
your drawings with collection numbers.
Exactly. So yeah, and again, kind of, I was more engaging them as the collection, which is kind of nice that, and, you know, I don't know what the, I couldn't say what the title of the piece was, but I could say what the number, so I was kind of engaging this kind of more like library system of the objects. So, but then again, these conversations that we would have afterwards that would, you know, I'd lay out maybe 10 drawings, and in the course of 30 minutes or an hour, we would, you know, run through and just, you know, kind of just have like a mini class or like a study session with Francesco, learning from him. And also, so for him, it was, I think, an interesting thing of, since he has this knowledge of the collection, to kind of, again, see it through my eyes and see what kind of indicators could kind of call up for him.
I think the paradigm of blind dates that you evoked earlier really kind of, in a way, continued. We had a series of very lovely blind dates.
Exactly.
And also blind dates with the objects.
Exactly. No, exactly.
It's not planned.
Yes. And yeah, and just
we're sealed.
And the affinity, I think, was also like a key component of how this came. And just, again, just letting the affinity of an object be the reason to think about it. So here's another drawing and another set of notes. So, and these notes, I remember this conversation tended to kind of, Francesco, I think, was reflecting on, you know, collecting principles. So I'll just read my handwriting, which might be hard. Recomposing what had been shattered was like a collecting principle that I think he was talking about. And yeah, that's.
And I see some of the ideas we share. There is a cryptic reference to Shevirata Kelim, to the breaking of vessels and the idea of a world. It's a Kabbalistic idea of the world as a shattered place and all the fragments that need to be brought back together.
Yeah.
So the idea of collecting as a way to bringing fragments back together is one of the ideas we floated.
Yeah.
So I'll just kind of wrap up with just a couple more images for you to look at. So this was kind of, I thought this was funny. This is just strange sculpture, and I remember the first thing Francesco said is, you know, scary. What is it? You know, he had to kind of like dig in and sometimes not knowing the object, but then having this kind of more material culture on the fly study moment of trying to almost decipher the drawing to think about what it could have been and then bringing back kind of the memories that might have been.
Yeah. I mean, obviously nobody can be familiar with 17,000 objects but all at once, but I feel like sometimes I'm engaged in an act of for trying to forget about it. Like I'm often so obsessed by the collection that I feel like I need to put a distance of trying to forget. So this one I just didn't know.
Yeah.
So like, oh, what is this? But there are others that I had to reacquaint myself
with. Right, exactly. So, and then we ended up really, at least I ended up really kind of focusing on some of these amulets and the idea that, just how the kind of coding of an object, the kind of purpose of an object. So we talked a lot about amulets and how an amulet can be just writing or, you know, the way that an object is kind of intended to be used. So this is a little piece of writing on amulets. There's some buttons, pins. So then in the show we ended up, you know, putting all these notes and drawings and then a piece of writing that Francesco did all together with a few of the original objects. So yeah, and then we had this final piece of it, which was in kind of thinking so much about amulets and what kind of a charged object is, and, you know, the idea of it being passed from perhaps generation to generation for a purpose, you know, safety, you know, it's supposed to go under the crib and protect the baby, and then you, once that's no longer necessary, you pass that along. So the object is really kind of a tool. We talked about the idea of almost kind of creating our own little symbolic gesture towards an amulet. So I etched a copper plate with some of the, you know, I did an etching of a series of drawings, and we kind of had this whole organizing principle for it, which seems like another thing that amulets tend to have. And then at the opening, we kind of had this mini ceremony of people helping lay out this clock on the floor and passing the object around and sent it off into the world, which it's still out there. So anyway, that's what I want to share, and we can talk more about it. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, David. First, I want to say something about Francesco, which is that you're the most amazing curator I've ever worked with, and I'm sure we all share that feeling, that that we're very grateful for your challenging and encouraging guidance, and your beautiful, gentle, and generous way of access, opening up the access to this fabulous collection. So, a lot of respect and a lot of gratitude. Mm-hmm. Thank you. And then I have a question for you before we carry on, which is, you just had a baby, right? So did you put an amulet under the crib of the...
I did surround it, you know,
there were certain choices about what objects were in there, in that room. Not necessarily specifically, amulet, but yes, he was on my mind. Yeah,
they're magical things.
Yeah,
okay,
yeah.
Sounds good. Okay, so that sounds great. So I'm going to talk about another project that was part of the attention show that closed a few months ago, and it was in dialogue with amulets as well, and so that's the connection. My attempt was to make an amulet that is contemporary, and I thought of amulets as things that you use as portals for meditation. So when you think about the spiritual, you need a way to get from the worldly to the spiritual, and the amulet for me is a way of the shiviti actually is a way that people can transition from the daily life into a spiritual realm. And it's a ritual that repeats, and it's kind of cryptic and kind of hard to read, and so you have to sort of tilt your head to see what it says, although you probably know what it says anyways, but it's that passing through the gate and tilting your head into this utter space that I think is so beautiful. And so in the conversation about these shiviti, I asked Francesco where the menorah shape comes from, and he explained that one of the origins is the night vision of Zacharias. And so it's a very beautiful text where Zacharias experiencing a vision, but he's confused, and he asks the angel, what's going on? And the angels explain, ask him to tell him what he sees, and they ask him, what seest thou? And he's like, well, I see, you know, trees and fire and bowls and wires and tubes, and the oil goes from one place to another, and he can't quite make sense of it, but then the angels help him sort it out. And that moment where you don't quite understand what's going on yet is the liminal space of discovery, before you discover something. And to me, that's a wonderful feeling, because if you're open to that, then you're also open to whatever comes afterwards. And so I tried to make an animation of that would go with the shiviti, and I can show you a little bit about this. So first of all, the origin of the elements I used is a collection of not 17,000, but sorry to say 4.5 million artifacts of memory that were made by people who participated in GeoCities, an early online experience where you can make your own website, you can host your website. And of course, everybody had to have a GIF animation on there, because there were words, and then there was music, but then there was feelings. And feelings are best expressed through animation, because feelings are things that change, they move, and so they have to have emotion. And so, you know, from motion comes emotion, and so that's where the GIF animations come from. So I have a little test here for you. So this archive of 4.5 million GIFs, if you anybody can give me a search term, I'll try and find something that would match that search terms. And this is all in the Internet Archive and is stored there for perpetuity, I guess. So anybody have a search term for me?
Artist,
okay, so we'll enter that, thank you. It's loading. And now we'll see, of course that's a GIF animation as well. And here we have artists, someday famous artists, there we go. I like that. And then there's an artist painting and paying attention. See, this is also kind of a Shiviti moment here, or the power of attention, he's looking and painting. And of course there's the animated palette, this is a crazy thing. Can you imagine that happening, like this spinning disco palette with it? Anyways, these and GIFs have a certain kind of property, which is that they're transparent, and that makes it possible to make beautiful constructions. So here's the actual slideshow, and we'll get a, so this is the basic elements I was working with, which you can see up here. There's a pea stub and a ring and the sun that are all there somewhere. And there's another element, which is that these animations, we see one of their many frames at once, and then the way it works is you see the ring stay in one position, and then it turns a little bit, and the previous image gets erased, and then the next image of the ring in the new position gets written over, and then that image gets erased, and so forth. And that's how we have the impression of something moving, similar to cinema in some ways. And but if we don't erase the images, we get the trail of all the images that that the animation contains, especially if we move those. And that was with a confusing, sort of beautiful, poetic element that I wanted to make for night vision. But if we look at this, so the nice thing is you can take these elements and just drag them over, and because they're transparent, you can layer them on top of each other. And that's a lovely effect. So here we have some kind of, I don't know what this is. What do you call this thing?
It's kind of, it does have a little bit of a bear quality to yeah, it's just straight on.
A cow bear, what do you get? Okay, yeah, so it's because of the layering and the movements, it's very elusive, it's not something we explicitly know what it is, but we can have all sorts of responses to it. So then we put this together, and we also put it together with the drawing of a menorah, and then we get this kind of animation, which are, these are screenshots from the program that ran for a year in the gallery. I must say I was very happy that it actually ran for a year and didn't really crash, right? Yeah, I was kind of surprised. Yeah, good, amazing, good. So
it was different every day.
It was different every day, I'm going to show this. And so now it's a program, it only really exists on a computer, but if you collect it, you have to sort of make it work for a time when this computer won't exist anymore. So Julie and Francesco and I were coming up with an innovation that we'd make a tapestry out of it. So we're going to choose, and you can help me choose tonight which is the right tapestry to print, to weave. We're going to weave tapestries out of some of the still moments of this, and this might be one at the very beginning, right, where you see just a few elements coming together, and then there's another one here where they progressed even more just a few minutes later, and there's one here that this is really quite the night vision, right? It's really dark, and there's a lot of colors that are blending here, and but then the menorah is drawn, and after a while it gets erased again because there's a constant tug between the worldly and the spiritual, and the worldly erases the spiritual sometimes, and then sometimes the spiritual erases the worldly. Mm-hmm. And so they're in a constant dialogue. Maybe it's not an erasure, but more of a resonance. And then here's another one. I quite like this one, actually. I could imagine this one's a tapestry. Yeah? There's a lot of subtle colors that might be woven, and has little flames on top. And what you have here is a whole bunch of GIF animations that deal with spiritual topics, like one says welcome, the other there's DNA floating around in here, there's, you know, pea stubs and rings, and there's Star of David, here's some DNA floating around, see? It's got to have something to do with the spiritual, right? Something's got to be encoded in there, I don't quite understand it. And here's another early, so every time it starts up, it changes its colors, and there's slightly different color nuances. Here you have the spinning Star of David, and of course it leaves this long animation trail that is quite surreal, and it's kind of like memory. It's, there is something we pull out, and it leaves a trail behind as well. And
it's very interesting, and in order to describe this, you have to use still images, right?
Well, I'm going to come to the video in just a moment, yeah. So these are some of the tapestries that we're, I think this one's a winner too. Doesn't this one look glorious? Yeah. And the colors are a little extreme here, but I think when it's woven, it'll be lovely. So I'm interested in how the artwork goes from a digital state to a material state as well. So now I have a little clip here of what it actually sounded like, because one aspect of Francesco's embrace of the collection is that he cares about every aspect of it, the people, the objects, their histories, and even their sounds. And the sounds you will hear are actually sounds of Francesco manipulating the some of the objects that have little bells on them.
To be specific, was actually Julie Franklin who was playing the object.
Ah.
So I got the registrar to shake
the professional. That was the professional registrar shake. Yeah, because if you shake it too hard, you know, it could break, right? So the registrar knows just how to do this.
Neurosurgeon.
All right, so, and my collaborator, I want to acknowledge here, Olya Dubatova, who's a colleague of mine. We've worked together with a lot of projects. And, so this, you saw the green version, because that day was there, I took the pictures, was green, but here is a blue version, because that was a blue day. And then here you hear the bells. And these bells are for... So as you see that over time the menorah inscribes itself and then it gets over-inscribed with other elements as well. And it's got quite a common presence, and every time two GIF animations collide on the screen, they both cease to exist, they resolve in a little sort of sparkle. And what they do, however, is they also produce that sound. So those sounds are not entirely randomly, but they're sort of randomly coming every time these two GIF animations collide with each other. And so that's the piece, and of course the code and the tapestries and the video will all be part of the collection, which is, I think, is really wonderful. And it brings up a lot of questions about how to hold on to these things, because the bigger topic for me is how do we pull things out of the archive, and when we do, they become part of the repertoire. So there's a relationship, there's like an iceberg at the tip of the iceberg, and here there's an archive, and there's the repertoire, the things we bring up again and again. And many things actually are hard to bring up because they're either painful or difficult or unstable, or we don't know what their meaning is anymore, or we've simply forgotten about them. Or in this case, they actually would be technically very hard to bring up. Say 10 years from now, nobody will understand this code, and it'll be difficult to resurrect. So the only real way to keep it going is to every year update it somehow. That's one of the things we're looking at, how to do that. And so to never stop asking the question about how can this exist.
Yearly maintenance.
Yearly maintenance. And that is actually bring us back to the topic of the spiritual. And I think in spiritual dimensions, we also have to do what is called, I guess, daily maintenance of tuning ourselves into the world around us, and maybe the hidden world and the world beyond. And that is a daily ritual that should happen. And so that's how the whole Shiviti process comes full circle, perhaps. So I'll stop there.
Well, I just wanted to add that, of course, I saw the many iterations of this project.
This is version 24,
yeah.
Yes.
And sometimes late at night, and on YouTube, you used to post these things on Vimeo and on YouTube, and I would get these emails at night and see, and what do you think of this and that. I remember one of the pivotal moments for me was when we discussed the directionality of the drawing. Where should the menorah be drawn from?
Yes.
The base, the stem, and this is a very special menorah, as we were saying, it's from the night vision of Zechariah, and so it also includes at the two sides these two trees that are either feeding or being fed.
No, right?
It's a very complex process. So
can I spend another minute on that?
Of
so,
course.
So, yeah, so
study the text.
The text talks about two trees, and one of them represents the spiritual power, and the other one represents the worldly power. And the whole point of the text is that the spiritual and the worldly tree produce oil. And those oils flow together in the menorah in 7 or 49 bowls. It's not quite clear.
It's absolutely not clear.
Yeah. And I'm going to stop it here. Otherwise, we're going to get in trouble. So there's a movement that goes from the earth into the oil and up into the menorahs, and then the light shines from there, and the light should guide us, I guess, that is the light of the spirit, to figure out how the balance of the world and the spiritual is ideal and then produces this energy that we can thrive on. So it's a linear motion in these directions, but then also there's a linear motion across as well, because the two have to come together across the y-axis, right? But then if you really look at it, it's actually a circular motion because the energy keeps going around and around and around. Those three elements, the vertical, the horizontal, and the circular, they're all present in the form of the menorah as we've drawn it, as we know it traditionally. So whenever I look at it now, I'm like thinking about how deep and complex that really is, and it's very, very gratifying. So thanks for sorting that out with me.
Well, thank you for making me understand a bit more about the text that I continue to not understand. I really learned a lot.
It's been really exciting to have the work installed and up in the show, and also to think about the ways that these objects sort of bleed into my larger art practice. So I prepared slides that are mostly reference material and then the work itself that's up in the show. I guess I just wanted to also articulate that I work primarily with ceramics. I also have a textile practice, which were sort of satisfyingly both part of this project, which is something that doesn't happen that often for me. But I came to ceramics as like a high school student, but have as a adult been really interested in the way that ceramics is an archival material, and so the relationship between the sort of permanent nature of ceramics and then maybe more ephemeral idea of, say, like queer and trans bodies and lives is something that I've been sort of dealing with a lot in my work. And I guess getting to work in this ceramic material and then to have it in this context of other archival objects that are being sort of cared for is a really kind of satisfying blending of practices. This is an image of an Ashkenazi prayer shawl that Francesco had me come in and look at. This is the tallit, the prayer shawl that I grew up with and what I was most familiar with. When Francesco invited me to come look at objects that were part of the Karaite Jewish tradition, he was interested in me looking specifically at the fringes that are attached to these prayer shawls. So this is kind of what my reference point was. These are some images that I took on my phone the day that I came in to look at these objects. And as I sort of sat with these images of objects, the thing that really stuck out to me was the way that the fringes were attached to the corners of these prayer shawls. So just to sort of like go back and reference this first image, what I had been really aware of was the way that the tzitzit, the fringes sort of knotted into a often, sort of finished buttonhole into the corner. Seeing an object like this where the fringes were movable had some sort of interchangeability, I thought was really fascinating. And as I began to sort of dig into Karaite Jewish practices, the thing that really stuck out is that Karaite, which I think means readers, is this community of Jews who use Torah as the kind of be-all and all of Jewish law. And I had recently, this past summer, gone to a queer Talmud camp to study Talmud for a week with other queer Jews, and was really inspired by the sort of back and forth conversation of Talmud and the way that Talmud as a document and as a practice was this sort of fluid exchange of ideas that often sort of canceled each other out. So, you know, learning that Karaite practices really sort of shunned Talmud and rooted itself in Torah as this kind of immutable authority in terms of Jewish law, I thought was really fascinating, particularly because these fringes are not immutable. They're very much interchangeable.
They seem to be the opposite of what one would think the Karaite for, right?
Exactly, yeah. And
so it teaches a lot about the fact that maybe we don't really understand what Karaism is to this day. So we're learning a lot about history by thinking.
Right. And I think that, I mean, even just the mechanism was really fascinating to me. And I think something I've thought about in my own practice as I sort of interact with other ceramic objects is the fact that ceramics is a very like non-diasporic material. Like it just doesn't travel well. It's incredibly fragile and heavy. And so the idea of how objects sort of move through space and are able to be maintained or passed on is something that I'm constantly thinking about negotiating. So the idea that one's fringes could be something that travels almost independently of the shawl was really inspiring to me. A lot of the work that I've done in the past is looking at ritual objects and thinking about sort of what speculative ritual objects could be. I've done some work with other archives in the past, specifically the GLBT historical archives in San Francisco, and then the one gay and lesbian archives in LA, doing work around speculative historical objects. So specifically looking at the sort of gaps in queer and trans history and imagining what the objects that could potentially have been used in specific instances could look like, and then actually creating those objects. So I moved forward with essentially creating sort of speculative ritual objects. I also included this image, which is a cell phone photo of my bar mitzvah tallit bag, just to sort of give reference to, again, like what my sort of aesthetic and sort of functional point of reference was in terms of how ritual objects move through the world. So this is very much how my prayer shawl that I received as a 13-year-old was given to me and then still, you know, sits near my bed in. So this is the object that I made for the current show. And I think the idea was looking at the way that the Karaite fringes were attached and sort of trying to highlight that attachment point and to sort of reference it as this really integral way and possible alternative ritual altogether. So I made these ceramic buttons, which are literally like a thumbprint of mine into a piece of clay, and then the knotted buttonholes, and then I embroidered this tiny bag with the idea that if one's fringes are able to be interchangeable, then one would need not a tallit bag, not a large bag for the shawl itself, but a small bag for the fringes to be transported, maybe with this fantasy of maybe one would have buttons on all of their garments, and the thing that would move through space would be the fringes, not the shawl itself. And yeah, so then this was installed with the objects that I showed, that I looked at from the archives, which I think was exciting to see them sort of in relationship to each other and also having almost a similar weight together in terms of their usage, even though mine is sort of a speculation or sort of a fantasy or imagining of their usage. Here's a detail of the little buttons. You know, I've been really fascinated by, you know, I mentioned the archival nature of ceramics and the way that ceramic as a sort of plastic material, meaning sort of like flexible material, records the hand in its making. So this idea of like pressing my thumb into the buttons itself and the shape of the button being a record of my finger in the material was something that I was really excited about. And
I was particularly fascinated by essentially the fact that you invented a new ritual object. The bag to hold the ritual fringes of the prayer shawls. It's an object that doesn't exist, but now it does. And it's in that console. Just that for me was such an opening moment. You know, living sort of most of my days with all these objects, the idea that the canon continues to be expanded, that this act of creativity can really prompt a whole new direction is really fascinating. So
thank you.
Strike of genius.
Thank you.
And I would say, you know, first of all, thank you for your kind words, but I'm not the only person, and we have not acknowledged the rest of the team. I would like to invite Julie Franklin to join us, because as you all know, all of this does not happen in a vacuum, and it's not just lovely conversations or emails in the middle of the night, but it's actually making things happen, and Julie has been a phenomenal partner in crime all these years, in figuring out how to, as we're trying to do, really make this collection and stand by what we're trying to foster, an open source collection where students and artists and others can come and go through the, you know, the sacred doors of collection storage and play with us, but also by yourselves and think with us and about what the implications are, both in terms of the safety of the 17,000 memory objects themselves and their use and their display and their preservation. So there are all kinds of topics here. But before we hear from Julie, I just wanted to say that it's been wonderful collaborating, I think, for all of us, and we were very happy to have you here tonight, and that you're here together. Collaborating with you, and I think we've all learned so much by your gaze, by your deep understanding of what we do in ways that I feel we don't understand. So it's so mutually enriching, and it translates into actual artwork that others can appreciate, and so it's really so much fun and so important. And also actually hearing you talk about all this, thinking about you're clearly part of that very special sort of breed of artists who also are artists in the way they discuss their work, which is a rare and wonderful thing to experience. So thank you very, very much.
I'm gonna give him open access, and I said, what? Okay, all right, well, let's see how we can do this. So there was a lot of not just building, teaching David how to handle artwork, but it was also me learning how to trust that people could come into the collection. I would train them well enough so that they could handle the objects safely. the chair, and although I at this point I'm starting.
You become a trendsetter.
So. But we've really started making inroads, I think, with understanding what to do with Greg's work and having the physical manifestation of woven textiles that are based on the pixelations is one aspect that I think is actually the easiest part of it. For me, still more difficult parts of it are actually that act of putting it onto a computer that really needs to change and develop. It's a very volatile media, as you can imagine. You know, Apple comes out with a new phone every year, so everything else that they're doing on top of it is constantly changing the technology. So it's true, we really can't just leave it on the hard drive somewhere on the shelf. We really have to. It kind of reminds me of those kids' games that were back in the, I think it was the late
90s.
Tamagotchi. Yeah, you have to keep feeding them. So it's like we have to pay attention to them. So,
a living digital creature.
Yeah, it's been setting up a lot of interesting conversations with people. So thanks, Greg, for helping me come into the 21st century as well.
Thanks for not saying no.
Yeah, the, Greg had asked us to see if we could somehow start paying artists in cryptocurrency, and I think it was just like I might have had a meltdown slightly, but still trying to figure that out. It's
okay.
Very interesting. And then in working with Nikki, it always amazes me how artists never fail to find a way to give me conundrums and challenges. Because Nikki wanted to display her pieces we had talked a lot about how to display her pieces and possibly displaying them with our actual prayer shawls. And for preservation purposes, I can't really sew or apply something else onto an artifact that we already have. And even if it's done with the most amount of reverence, which I really feel like Nikki's work is totally based in respect for all the material that she sees. And again, with Francesco, I was really blown away by the fact that you just created this thing that is totally plausible. And I do have a question for you, and if that is, when this thing really does come into being and is into being in my mind, should people get to have their thumbprints in it, that own it? Is this something that is, will the buttons come with an ability to get the thumbprint in it? Like, wow, yeah.
I really like that idea too. and I think it's very possible. And I think like the accessibility of it, you know, to me, the idea of making buttons that were not these sort of, maybe in my mind, like exquisite, kind of like molded, really sort of clean objects offers the possibility of an accessibility that maybe something sort of manufactured couldn't have, and a possibility to, let people personalize them and, I love that. I think that's a great idea.
Well, and I also think that's part of the reason why we wanted to have your work separated from our pieces, because they are, I think every artist's work is very unique, and sometimes mixing it in with objects that exist in the collection, one becomes a prop to the other, and so it's possible then to kind of miss those finer details. And so when it's in a case by itself,
just saying all kinds of nice things about ourselves.
Yeah.
Maybe it's time to think. But it actually, the real process was actually a lot of self-criticism, a lot of self-investigation. So now it's the time to relax and enjoy after the fact. But it is a critical process. But if there are any contributions from all of you here, that's perfect time to hear them. Any remarks, we're happy to. And we can share one of these wireless microphones if anybody wants to contribute. Is there any remarks there? No? Yes.
There you go.
Thank you all. This is really, really joyous just to be so immersed in all of your creativity. And I have a question for you, Nikki. As someone who's part Karahite, but of my lineage, what I'm fascinated about is the Torah says that we have to have blue fringes, blue threads on our fringes, and Rabbinite Jews stopped doing that 2,000 years ago. Karahite Jews didn't. So that's the obvious distinction that I've always known about, and I love that that's not where you went. You went somewhere else. But I wonder if you have any thoughts about the obvious and if you want to share them.
Yeah, I mean, I definitely had thoughts about the inclusion of the blue thread, so thank you for bringing that up. I mean, I think that that's something that I considered, whether, like, sort of what direction I wanted to explore this in, and I think, I mean, I guess while this is still up, I can just skip back to the image of the Karahite fringes, and I think the thing that I was really struck by was, you know, I had never seen really in person any fringes that had a blue thread included in them, but I was aware of them. I knew that that was a thing. And I think what was so exciting about these was that the thread is not just a single included thread, but it's half of the fringe itself. So there's something really beautiful and sort of balanced about the idea of having this inclusion of this material, this sort of sacred material, the blue dye, as not just a sort of added or sort of singular part of this sort of whole fringe, but actually was half of, like, a really integral part of the object itself. Yeah, so I think that that was something that came up for me. I think that I'm really interested, sort of, I guess, research-wise, in the idea of circularity, just kind of in general, so the idea of having a fringe that is really balanced in its sort of half-and-halfness, I thought was really beautiful and was something I considered exploring and ultimately didn't, but yeah, thank you for that.
Mark back there.
So bear with me, so the question is a work in progress, so it might be a little long, but I'm looking and thinking about they are very directly related to the objects in our collection and how these objects actually originate from religious context, from religious use, and looking or thinking of the process that you went through, all three of you, when you were, you know, thinking about what you're going to create and the historical context and any kind of additional research and Francesco's thoughts. So I'm just wondering if you would say that this process of looking at these particular objects is something that you would go through regularly, or can you compare it to your work with other objects in other contexts? Thank you.
Well, again, in thinking about objects and kind of what they contain, you know, I showed that drawing of the shells, which again tends to, for me, there's more of like a kind of accessing my own memories, and the way that drawing for me is like implanting a memory. So the time spent looking and what that does to my brain and how that then kind of codes some moment. So again, for me, the experience of spending time with these objects as objects and kind of almost getting to know them and developing a new relationship with them was a pleasure. And yeah, and you know, I was, again, just in kind of coming to them very freshly and then kind of adding that context afterwards, that was like a really unique experience for me and something that I would love to continue to investigate. And I think in the, you know, even more specifically, you know, kind of copying writing and kind of that idea of like transcribing writing that you can't read and then bringing it to someone, and then he's can read, but then he's reading my halfway correct versions of the letter forms. You know, and again, there was like a lot of that kind of, yeah, just looking both formally and then in terms of beyond the formal. So I would love to continue that, and could imagine that study extending beyond this collection or deeper into the collection.
I think it's a good question. And I think in some way, maybe not every artist, but at least when I start making an art project, it's always about retrieving something and inverting something and letting go of something and creating something new. So these four parts have to all happen. And so, you know, sometimes you say you have to destroy something to create something, but then you also have to pull something back from the past and you have to sort of imagine something for the future. And so another project that's like that, I'm just going to play very briefly, is about a bell that never really rang. The Czar bell was too big to, it failed, it cracked before it ever rang. And but we were able to reconstruct the sound of it. And so that's another way of going back, and not to the night vision, but to this moment where, in 1732, where the Mulcherine foundry, people died trying to make this bell work, but it didn't work. And so the bell never rang for anybody, but then the question comes up, who would it ring for today? And so this is the sound we came up with. Oh, it's loud. It's a beautiful sound, right? And it's purely mathematical, and we see the deformations in the bell. So that kind of questioning the past always allows us to question the present and figure out where we're going to go from here. So it's a good practice.
I mean, I think that this process of working on this project has been really exciting because it's given me this opportunity to interact with these objects directly, and also I think the sort of fabricating or sort of imagining of rituals and ritual objects is something that is really, especially now, kind of like central to my independent art practice, and I think that that's just kind of how my brain works around ritual objects these days. I think that coming back into a relationship with Judaism as an adult, I've really had to reckon with this understanding of being a queer and trans person whose body and community is not really represented in sort of a Jewish practice, and so almost being removed or exempt from a lot of the ways that Judaism is practiced sort of in a normative sense has opened up the possibility to just imagine what my kind of Jewish practice could look like and to just let it be sort of fluid and experimental. And I imagine that for some or like many folks, that's hard or sort of not nice to think about, but I think for me it's very much about creatively dealing with the reality of interacting with a practice and identity that is important to me, and I've really been trying to sort of integrate into my life more as an adult now.
So when you talk about creatively interacting with the religion, that's a funny thing for many people, because for many people religion is rules and traditions and faith, and don't, you know, but sometimes even don't question it, and this is far more widespread than one might think, that the notion that religion either is interesting because we don't have to question it, or it's not interesting because we can't question it. But you're saying, no, this is great, I get to be creative in that specific way, and this is old saying about traditions, the only traditions that are dead are the ones that we don't question anymore. And so that's a very beautiful way of being creative in particular. So I appreciate that, and I wonder if all art has some aspect of that, you know, world making or other world making, or where you get to be creative like that.
Yeah, I mean, I think a lot about sort of who's making the ritual objects that we're interacting with, and whose hand is getting to bring these objects into the world, and how did they feel about those objects. And I think for a lot of sort of archival objects, or even like the ritual objects that I grew up with, they're it's all sort of like fantasy, like I have no idea who these people were. And so I think being somebody who's very focused on objects and really interested in the creation of objects, the idea of sort of falling into a practice, but also sort of a lineage of people making ritual objects, has been really important and really central to how I make objects and how I think about objects, and specifically how I think of myself as Jewish and related to a Jewish practice and history.
Daily practices and reconfiguring the Bay Area one tile at a time. Religious aspects to that.
Yeah, I mean maybe spiritual. Yeah. You know, I think there maybe is a distinction between religious and spiritual. So, yeah, personal spirituality.
I mean, just the fact that you go to the same place.
Yeah.
How many days in a row?
Yeah, no, and that's why I love to drawing, is to like bring that into my life.
So. And then when you drew these objects, did they have spiritual resonance for you, or is it just the drawing?
Well, again, I think that there's the kind of the act of focus and spending that time with a thing that you have to do to draw it. And so, yeah, no, I did. There was some energy transfer happening. Yeah.
So all of your projects with the Magnus are very meta in a way. You're interacting with the collection and then adding to the collection as a reaction to the collection. So something that I've been thinking about and hearing you all speak, and I've had the pleasure of working with both Greg and Nikki, and I was still a student when David was working here, is that how does this sort of redefine our understanding our understanding of the archive as something that could be mutable or viable or breathing or living. And can this sort of model be carried out in other museum institutions? Yeah, thank you.
I'm not gonna answer that. I don't know how to do that. But if anybody has any ideas, I mean, definitely the circular motion we described is probably the way to address this question.
Yeah, well, I do think that it does kind of hinge on the role of the registrar in a way, because responsibility for the objects, you know, that responsibility can look very different depending on how you see your role and And it's kind of like the, you know, just the idea of, you know, what you're saying, like the tradition, like how to almost see your role as a way of bringing life to the objects and letting some of that porousness into the equation, even if ultimately your job is to protect and preserve, but knowing that actually in there is like some room in there, and interaction can be done in a way that, you know, is generative and safe. And I think that's a really inspiring
thing. There's some thought in the museum world finally where people understand that access, the collections are alive and interesting when people see them, when people interact with them. And since there is so much two-dimensional looking at the world right now through a very small screen, having the authentic experience of being with an authentic thing is really important. So I think there are lots of places that are starting to really think about this question, and maybe the access isn't directly hands-on, but that there's ways you can actually access the collection, like there's the Brooklyn Museum of Art has this open storage place, and so you're having places like that, but hands-on collection I think is still very experimental, and I think because we're research-based anyway, which a lot of collections are not, it makes me feel, I think, like that it's okay, especially with careful people. If I see somebody eating peanut butter and jelly, then I'm not
happy. Well, they're not just, they're people you train to, right? That we train to work with collections. So that's, and as Julie was saying, we, in a way, piloted this project with David, that then got expanded to students working with us on a daily basis. We have students going in and out of storage and working with artifacts and other materials. So that's definitely a way in which the archive continues to be enriched, because we are learning from the way in which our students are seeing and interacting with the materials. So again, this is, you know, like sort of like art that charts ways for life to be. Kind of what we're trying to do. I mean, in a way, I feel like you know, we kind of, and I speak here very much about Julie and I dreamt up this place, and in a certain way, and working with you has expanded that vision and made it feel more tangible, more like within reach. You know, that there is something there that eventually we can get to.
But back to your question, I was in a conversation with a curator from a museum that won't be mentioned in the Bay Area, but she was talking about getting an artist out of storage, and I was like, "And what do you mean?" And she's like, "Oh, you know, when we get a painting by Diebenkorn out or something like that, and we get the artist out of storage and so on." And but that manner of speaking meant that the art was actually the artist, and that the artist, in a way, by association, became an object. And here, because maybe many of the things you have are not really made by people you know, the art is an object, but the artist is not. The artist is sort of a mysterious, perhaps even living figure. And that gives you a head start, because if you had something that was worth $10 million and you had to, and then it would be a confusion between the object and the artist, and those artists that you have to get out of storage, they're much easier to deal with when they're dead. And so the question is, how do you conceive of the living artist and how she or he does work, and how does that relate to the concept of conservation at the museum? And that's a hard one to crack, because yes, I can understand it. There's some things, you know, where the object and the author are getting sort of packed into one, but that means that the author then becomes an object, not that the object becomes alive. That doesn't work that way.
It's
kind of a zombie moment.
Yeah,
you know?
I had this conversation about 20 years ago at a museum conference where somebody who shall remain nameless said...
The same nameless person
said, oh, we don't show living artists because they're too much of a problem. They have too many expectations of us and interfere. And I was really shocked, and I said, yes, but if the maker is alive, you can ask questions and keep asking questions, and you can ask them if they'll fix it for free. So you know, there's a lot of good things about having an artist alive. So,
oh, good, good.
We are weenies, you guys.
Yeah. Let me build on that.
Is there another question?
Is there more remarks?
I have a question.
Please.
Okay. Greg, this is a question for you. So when we're talking about digitizing things, going from a 3D object, making it 2D, way different experience when you're looking at that online. But when we look at night vision, essentially the same thing. How different was that for you and your own experience being the creator, you know, watching that on your personal computer screen or even putting it up here versus seeing it in the exhibition?
That's actually a really good question because I didn't really see how good it was, and that's not about my work, but the whole thing, how good it was until I saw it all come together. And that was a Eurovision, Francesco, I think, that you made a dark room full of magical shiviti and full of this bell sound occasionally and diagrams that explained what was going on, and it became something altogether different. I think animation has a nice way of being present, but the whole room became present in a different way because of the interaction between these very deep and silent and contemplative objects and the a little bit more noisy rattling that was happening occasionally.
It's kind of nice when things sort of come together. Huh?
Yes, and it had what you were alluding to earlier. It had some kind of aura that any of the pieces alone probably wouldn't have had. And so maybe that's something we get to do every now and then. We get to put things together and maybe even invoke some kind of a new ritual that didn't even exist before. That would be super creative. So, and just like your buttons, which have so much aura to them, that they ask for a ritual to be made around them. And yes, and so hopefully some of that translates on the screen as well, and it travels around in the world. But maybe not. Maybe you just have to come here. So,
well, and my sort of closing thought on all this is that we are all living here into a performative space. So that's exactly what we do. We're making things happen and trying to make some sense of it as we're doing it. In a previous life, also in this life, I'm very much concerned with sound, but in a previous life, I was working a lot in radio. And once I got interviewed about my radio work, and I understood something I had not realized before in speaking about it, which is that when I was doing radio, I always had my, you know, in the radio studio, you have your headphones on, because you need to hear all kinds of things that are going on that are not necessarily being broadcast. But I always have my volume very high. And I realized why, which is I was actually also listening to my own voice as if it were somebody else's and being my own sound critic, my own listener. And what I've been learning in working with each and all of you is actually translating that into vision, sense of vision and seeing things through multiple sets of eyes and experiences. So I feel like personally, professionally, I'm growing a lot through these experiences. But we're all making it happen, and it happens in real time. And it's like the planning happens in real time. And that's the glorious part of it. So thank you so much, really, and to each of you for the direct contributions to the collections. And yesterday David was here and came with a box of his drawings and donated them to the collection. So this project that started at a different institution in San Francisco and this blind date that Renny Pritkin put us on turned eventually into enriching the Magnus collection. So it was also his gift, your gift, and so that this kind of ecosystem that we're creating is really a very, very interesting, inspiring thing, but really like a heartfelt thank you, David, for donating to the collection. Julie and Ernest Jolly created a small display just of a few of the drawings that are in the back of the room, so as we leave, you're in the audience, welcome to take in these drawings. You kept them, maybe this, if that's okay, this is one last question and one last word to David who made this gift, but You kept a few for yourself, so you didn't give away the whole lot. How did you choose what to keep?
Exactly. Yeah, it's interesting for me since I d- do kind of have this relationship with drawings. You know, they are very personal, and even if they mean something different to someone else, it can be hard to let go of some certain things, and that's, I guess, a good thing. I looked through the set again in anticipation of this evening, and kind of always knowing that it made sense and was it felt right to have the collection end up here, but looking through did kind of, you know, just kind of see what might strike me as a handful to kind of hang on to, and also like be able to, I don't know, bridge that space from collection to the outer world. I just kind of, there's a few that, you know, when drawing, and I think, you know, this can be anyone's practice, I think you do often know when something happens that feels right, or there's like a moment where you feel like, oh yeah, that there was like a something that can't quite be defined happens when you're doing something. And that might be the first time you do something or learn something. There was a couple drawings that I felt like I wanted to spend a little more time with. And then again, for me, in looking at them in the future, I can kind of transport myself back into this building.
Thank you, and thank you all, and thank you all for coming and joining us tonight. We're still here at New York. We're sort of going offline now, but we're still here and happy to talk more with you. But thank you again very much.